So unfortunately, the topic of my talk is not as exciting as what we've seen right now, but it affects millions and millions of people, so I will go ahead with my slides. I want to talk about cancer, and I came to this topic from an area which is like machine learning and natural language processing because I was a patient. And the reason I got into it, because I felt we have no choice. We have to change it. And in the last 2 years, my group and I have been developing machine learning technologies to solve this problem. And particularly, I believe we can solve three specific fundamental issues in cancer care. The first one is access to care. So today, your survival rate is a function of your geographical location. Even within the United States, and here you can see the map of number of incidents versus mortality, you would see there is a very weak correlation between the number of incidents and mortality in the corresponding state. And of course, it relates to money, which brings us to the second problem in cancer care, is the cost. By most conservative estimates, we are paying $80 billion on the cancer care, not the research. And you can see that every year, that costs continue to grow, which is unsustainable. And the questions that we are all asking, what did we actually get by putting so much money into this care? And that's where I believe AI can really change it. If you look at the mortality rate, and this is mortality rate in the last decade, the decade in the United States, you would see that, of course, there is a decrease in mortality, which is a great news. But the decrease is very, very slow. Now, we know about cancers which are considered to be killers, like pancreatic cancer, where the survival rate is 7%. Some cancer, we are thinking that we cured them. For instance, breast cancer is one of those cancers, correct? The survival rate is 90%. Now, given the frequency of breast cancer, it translates into 500,000 women worldwide that are dying from this disease, and it didn't change in the last few years. So I can hardly say that we succeeded here. So I'm sure that many of you had a lot about different advancements in biology, in imaging, and in other areas where we are really making change in cancer care. One area, the one which is close to my heart, is actually didn't really participate until now in cancer care, and this is machine learning. So just to explain it to you, to give this feeling how primitive we are in terms of data processing, let's just look together at a very specific pipeline. I selected breast cancer, that's because I know it, but you can apply it to any other cancer. So the patient gets diagnosed, they get this very high resolution imaging, pathology and radiology, whatever, thousands of pixels. Then we have a human who goes and reads it and summarizes it into a page. And then from this page, we distill further few variables. And on these variables, we are making the treatment. So this whole clinical pipeline is actually the way to lose all the information which is personal to the patients. We're just leaking it throughout, and at the end, we are surprised why we cannot feed the treatment to the patient. And in this case, you can see pathology slides of four women. According to the variables, to these markers, they're exactly the same. Three of them survived and were fine, another one doesn't. Now, when you look in terms of variables, they all look the same, but their raw information is very different. And that's exactly the issue, that we are losing all the information to make this determination. Now I'm going to show you the slide that I routinely call travesty, and it comes from American Society of Clinical Oncology. They themselves put the statistics on their website. Today, all the clinical decisions in the United States are based on 3% of the population that participated in clinical trial. So if any of you or your loved ones were not part of clinical trial, their data is just not used. Now, many of you use machine learning or develop machine learning. It's just bizarre that we're throwing 97% of the data. And that's how our clinical pipeline today is done. So what we are trying to do at MIT, and you know, being the patient, I decided we have to change it. So my vision is to design models that can take data from millions of patients, all the raw data, the imaging, the pathology, the genetics, and from all this data to go directly to clinical predictions. And this prediction can be risk, it can be early diagnostics, sensitivity to treatment, and the disease progression models. And this is particularly important because in cancer care, you know, maybe we shouldn't be even medicating the patient because the chances of the success are so very low, and they need to be able to know what is the likelihood of the success. So, at any rate, when we started working on it, I realized what is the first problem, and the first problem is close to my area of research, which is natural language processing, that all the data about outcomes and types of cancer today is all in text, in a raw text, which machine cannot understand. And in many, many situations, doctors by hand take these clinical records and analyze it and put them in the computer, which we definitely cannot do for millions of patients. So the first things that we've done, we took all the data from partners' institutions, which include MGH, Dana-Farber, and others, and using natural language and machine learning, build a model which takes this data and translates into database format. This is a structured representation which machine can understand and manipulate, which records all the biomarkers, leaf invasion status, and other things. And you can see that the accuracy here is pretty high, and we have it for over 90,000 women. Now, what can you do with this database? Let's just look at how today clinicians study cancer on the clinical side. There is a particular condition that I brought you to show. It's called Atypia. In New England Journal of Medicine, there was an article recently published which only looks at a few hundred cases and make all the predictions based on them, when we have so many women with this condition. And the reason is they can only do it on so few cases was because they needed to do it by hand. They had to take by hand 10,000 records and identify the right ones and then encode it into the database. In our system, with one query, you can get 6,000 patients only in MGH alone. Another case where this kind of data and approach can help is preventing overtreatment. Today in cancer, if we are not sure, we go for the most conservative treatment. For instance, if a patient has high-risk lesion in breast, 100% of them are excised at MGH. Only 13% of them had cancer and benefited from the surgery. Isn't it bizarre? So with this data and known outcomes, we can identify 30% of the patients that were benign, didn't need the surgery. And again, there is a lot of place to do it in many other cases of overtreatment and other cancers. So when I started giving you my kind of big vision, I told you that I don't only want to do text. I really want to go to the raw data and get insights that human cannot have. And we started doing it with reading mammograms, which are x-rays of breast. We built deep learning models that can read them, getting very good performance. And here you can see video. You see I also have a video. At MGH in the cancer center, where the machine can actually read the mammogram. And here you can see Connie Lehman, who is the head of breast radiology and my dear collaborator, where machine processes the image, gets a prediction, and then she eventually signs it. And even though it's extremely exciting to see the tools implemented in clinic, what really drives me in this research is understanding how machines can do things that humans cannot do, correct? And let me show you an image which is of personal value. This is me in 2014 with my cancer diagnosed. And you can see that the cancer here, you know, it was diagnosed in 2014, but it was brewing in my breast for quite some time. And I can imagine that if machine would have caught it in 2012, my life would have gone in a very different direction. So, and we're talking about the best medical centers in Boston. Imagine how it looks like across many hospitals in the country. And there are lots and lots of research that demonstrates, done by doctors, that demonstrates that there are typically early precursors of cancer, for instance, in imaging, way before they're diagnosed by radiologists. So one thing that we are currently working very hard on is to predict cancer as early as possible and to look at your tissue, currently in breast, but hopefully we're now looking at lungs and other organs, and to say how likely you are going to develop cancer in 5 years. Okay, so hopefully now I convince you that machine learning can do something meaningful for diagnostics, but obviously we all want to get cure. That's how I titled my talk, Learning to Cure. So recently we started very exciting collaboration, actually 2 years, with people in chemical engineering and local pharmaceutical companies on using deep learning to design drugs, the process which currently is very much done by hand, very expensive. And here it's a great place to apply machine learning because you have so many reactions documented, and now we can do very well tasks which are hard for humans, like organic retrosynthesis, like lead optimization, and in some of these tasks, we're already doing better than humans. So I'm very excited about this direction. And finally, this is a slide for Eric, who said that in this section, we're going to be talking about applying the technologies. So my main, when I got into this, I didn't care whether I'm going to do new machine learning or old machine learning. I just wanted to change the field. But what I realized very soon, that you actually have to do new algorithms and new machine learning. And just to give you one example which changed my technical research direction, it's interpretability. Because one of the biggest barriers for using deep learning is the fact that we cannot understand why the model made this prediction. And if you want to be believed by the clinician and make them use this in their pipeline, you absolutely have to give the reason. And we developed a lot of new algorithms that enable to kind of open the black box and give you justifications. So I want to close my talk by showing this map. This time it's not on women, it's on men. It's a mortality map across the world, and the red means more mortality. And I firmly believe that with all our strengths in machine learning and in biology, in Koch Institute, in Broad, and other, our connections to the local hospitals, we really have a chance to wipe red from this map. Thank you.